Sir, Kumari L.J. Meera Memorial Endowment Lecture Program. And for this program, we have arranged a talk on Ayurveda, the science of healthy living. Ayurveda, as you know, is a very important tool, particularly in India, with the genesis. India is the place where it started. And today's speaker is Dr. Nivedita Srinivasa Murthy. I request you, madam, to come to the stage. This program has been arranged by Kumari L.A. Meera Memorial Trust donor. They are the donors. And today we have with us Dr. Karthik. He is one of the trustees of the this stand up for the today. This is Dr. Karthik. He is niece of L.A. Meera, I can say. And he is with us. And he is working in Bombay, in IIT Bombay. And he has come here today for this particular program. He is one of the trustees of the So I will just introduce, I welcome all of you for today's program. Before I introduce Kumari L.A. Meera to the audience, may I request you, Dr. Karthik, to give a brief account of your trust, and then we will introduce Kumari Meera and also the Dr. Vedita. I request you please come to the dais. So I welcome all of you for this today's program, and the doctor and all the family members of Meera. Please.
Namaskar. So on behalf of the Kumari L.A. Meera Memorial Trust, I welcome you all to the endowment program today. So Kumari L.A. Meera was the youngest daughter of Mrs. V.R. Sharada and Mr. L.K. Anantakrishnan. And she was born on June 1st, 1961 in New Delhi. So she had a continuously brilliant academic career. And after her schooling in Delhi, she obtained her B.Sc. Honours degree in physics from St. Stephen's College in Delhi, securing the first rank in the university. She then joined IIT Madras for her MSc degree in physics in 1983, again securing a rank there, and then obtained an M.Tech in computer science again from IIT Madras. At the end of that, she was very academically inclined and had a multidimensional personality. But apart from academics, she was also a very good singer and debater, and won several awards even in sports. So she was very dedicated to the pursuit of knowledge, and she had a very well-developed spirit of scientific inquiry. So this led her to opt for a career in teaching and research in mathematical sciences. With this purpose in mind, she went to the Department of Physics at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia in September of 1985 to pursue her PhD studies. Unfortunately, before she could fulfill the great promise she had shown till then, she met with a tragic end in November 1985 in Philadelphia. So Kumari Meera's intelligence, friendly openness and gentle nature endeared her to all those who were privileged to have known her. So setting aside his personal grief, her father, Sri L.K. Anantakrishnan, founded the Kumari L.A. Meera Memorial Trust in memory of Kumari Meera in August 1989 in Palghat, Kerala. Since Meera's own promise remained unfulfilled, his vision was that he wanted many more such Meeras to come up, and so dedicated himself to encouraging young students, especially girls, to take up science education and research. Sri Anantakrishnan, who was also the first managing trustee of the trust, was the driving force behind all the activities of the trust and nursed the trust through its fledgling years with infinite patience, great wisdom, compassionate nature, and his keen understanding of law and administration. So under his care, the trust has earned a name for itself, especially in the field of science, education and motivation. So the trust is dedicated to the service of mankind with a wide range of activities in the fields of physics, mathematics, computer science, as well as social welfare, Indian culture and anthropology. So the main focus of the trust is to foster scientific interaction and activity in physics, mathematics and computer science with various institutions, as well as to encourage scientific education and advance scientific research in these fields. So the trust provides several grants, scholarships and stipends for deserving and meritorious students, and has instituted several scholarships for the encouragement of meritorious students at institutions such as the Indian Institute of Technology in Madras, St. Stephen's College, Delhi, and Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, to name a few, other than various other schools. So the trust is managed by a board of trustees, several of whom include several top academics. And finally, I'll just say that the trust is solely dependent on donations from individuals and organizations to sustain its activities. On behalf of the board of trustees, I appeal to all of you who share its ideals to donate funds liberally, which will be gratefully acknowledged. So all donations are, needless to say, eligible for exemptions under Section 80G of the Income Tax Act. So further details are available with the IIWC office. So with that, I...
Thank you, Dr. Karthik, for introducing the trust, about talking about the trust, and also about Kumari L.A. Meera, who was a bright student and a scholar with untimely death. It's really very sad, and the family has instituted this trust, and they have given a donation to us, and every year we are conducting this program on behalf of the trust. So I welcome all of you for today's program, and I'm going to introduce now today's speaker. As you know, today's speaker is Dr. Vijayanta Srinivasamurthy. She's here with us. Dr. Vijayanta Srinivasamurthy is a graduate in BAMS Ayurveda from Government Ayurveda Medical College in Bangalore, and MSCP Master in Counseling and Psychotherapy from Coimbatore University, Shivamogga. She has had a vast experience, 10 years as an Ayurvedic practitioner, 6 years as unit head of Panchakarma at Sri Sri Ayurveda Panchakarma Department, Art of Living. She is working in the Art of Living. 4 years of private practice, currently practicing at Dr. Nivedita Ayurveda at Kalyanagar, Bangalore. Her activities are, she has presented a talk on Ayurveda in 100 episodes in popular Kannada channel like Shankara TV, Ayush TV, Suvarna TV, Samaya TV, and Chandana TV. She has written around 30 articles in various online national and international health forums and health websites. Has presented talks on women's health, stress management, Ayurveda lifestyle in colleges, in like Shashadvipram College, Sri Sri College, and in banks, particularly for banks, you know, it's a stressed, a lot of stress will be there for those employees. So she has given in banks like SBI and PNB, and Rotary Club in Delhi, schools in Delhi and Chennai, and also in ex-service, Servicemen Association. She has conducted over 23 Ayurveda camps in Bangalore. And today, on our invitation, she is with her, she is with us, and she is delivering a talk on Ayurveda. And I welcome all of you. I welcome her on behalf of all of you. And we will clap her. She is going to speak on Ayurveda for about 45 minutes, and we will devote a few minutes, 15 minutes for question and answers, because it is a very important talk and everybody will have health problem in life, so it is better to interact with the audience. So we allow 10-15 minutes for questions. Let the questions be brief so that she can answer in time. So I welcome once again all of you and the speaker today and all the family members for this.
You want to say something?
So I didn't see, sorry. So we light the lamp before we start the lecture, and I request Dr. Karthik Madam, you come and any members of the family also can join us. So now I will request her to begin her talk. Thank you very much. So in any point of time you feel I'm going too fast or you're not able to understand anything, please stop and ask me any doubts if you have in between also. In the end, we'll again have some 10 or 15 minutes of interaction if you have any doubts, if you want to know more about Ayurveda. And if there are things that you feel you can't ask in a forum, I will be waiting 10 minutes after the presentation. You can come and speak to me then if you have something personal to share with me. Now, the entire talk is about what exactly Ayurveda is, how Ayurveda can help you lead a better life, a healthier life than what you have already been leading. So for that, let us first understand what Ayurveda actually is. I'm sure we all have our own idea about Ayurveda before coming here. So what is the normal things? Herbs and leaves. This is what advertisements have done to us. You know, every time you see something about an ad about Ayurveda, they will show you something green and a lot of leaves, somebody is pounding something. This is the idea we get when we say this Ayurveda. The second is safe, no side effects. Ayurvedic medicines are very safe, madam. We have no side effects. In fact, it is so safe that some people feel they don't even need a doctor to prescribe our medicine. They can take it directly from the physician, from the chemist shop, you know. They can take it directly from the medicine because it is so safe. Then it is a traditional medicine. True, it is traditional, but we have adapted a lot to the modern times, to suit to the modern needs. And the other portion of Ayurveda is it is very slow. I'll come to that portion later. There are a few of us here who don't think Ayurveda is a system of medicine at all. They think it is mostly like a spa. You know, what is Ayurveda? It's about massages, and then you have herbal Ayurvedic beauty parlors, or you know, some Ayurvedic pain relief clinic. It is mostly external. They don't think of it as a complete system of medicine. And there are some of us who are very skeptical about Ayurveda. You know, Ayurvedic doctors, some of them are quacks. There is no quality control in Ayurvedic medicines. And, you know, they use their own preparations. And I'm afraid that they will add steroids to whatever medicines that we're using. And there is a big, you know, issue about Ayurvedic medicines containing heavy metals, toxic chemicals. This, again, I will come to later. Now, there are others, you know, mostly this IT sort of crowd, this Google-educated crowd amongst us, who think, you know, does Ayurveda have a scientific basis? It has been there for 5,000 years, but is it scientifically validated? Or, you know, is it applicable to the current age? It was written 5,000 years ago. Today we are in a completely different era. Is it really applicable to this age? These are all the doubts that come in our minds when we say about Ayurveda. Let us break everything down one by one. What is Ayurveda? It is true. We use herbs and leaves, but it is not just about herbs and leaves. It is not just about massages. We broadly say Ayurvedic Panchakarma treatment as massages. But they are actually therapies. Fomentation therapies, we have got lay pumps. But if I just say lay pump to a common man, he will not be able to understand. So we have
grouped everything under massages for the convenience of people, for to enable people to understand it better. But Ayurveda treatments, Panchakarma treatments are not just about massages. We use specific powders, specific, a different medicine for every illness, even when it comes to our external therapies. Then it is not just beauty treatments. All the products, beauty products these days in the market is Ayurvedic. You take a moisturizer, it is Ayurvedic. You take a shampoo, it is Ayurvedic. But they really cannot be Ayurvedic, because to make a shampoo, you have to add a certain amount of chemical to make it. And the question of it becoming Ayurveda doesn't exist at all. But we are generally, you know, easily used Ayurvedic terms for everything. Ayurvedic soap, what not. Everything is Ayurvedic these days. And it is not just about detox, de-stress. We can actually treat your diseases. It is not something wherein, you know, you just go casually, get a detox, get a body cleansing done. It is not like that. This is a proper system of medicine, and we can scientifically treat each and every one of your diseases. Now, to understand what Ayurveda is, I keep calling Ayurveda science. If I say Ayurveda is a science, there should be a logic behind it. It should have a principle behind it. And when there is logic, when there is science, even if it is 5,000 years old, it still stands true. Of course, we have made certain adaptations to suit the modern needs, but the science remains the same. So, when I say, you know, when I give medicine for diabetes, I am not an Ayurveda Vaidya, because it is an allopathic or a modern system medicine diagnosis for diabetes, for your sugar levels. If I give you a pill, I cease to be an Ayurveda Vaidya. If I have to be an authentic Ayurveda doctor, I have to diagnose it on the Ayurvedic parameters. I have to diagnose it, understand it, and then treat it on Ayurvedic parameters. That is authentic Ayurveda. So what is this authentic Ayurveda? We stick to some core principles. The main focus is everybody is different. So if you say, can you give me some medicine for cold? What is the medicine for cold in Ayurveda? I don't have an answer, because the cold medicine for her is different from a cold medicine for him, because every individual is different. We all feel that, right? I know I'm very unique and special, and we agree with you. You are unique and special, and identifying this individuality is the first step we do as Ayurvedic doctors. And so, for the same disease, our prescription will be different for different people. And emphasis is also based on a region, the kind of food habits they have, the kind of lifestyle they have. For example, if a Kannada person or a Kannadiga person in Bangalore has curd rice in the night and he got a cold, I can understand why he got a cold. But if a Tamilian who has been used to curd rice at night and has it in Chennai, he had a cup of curd rice in Chennai at night and he still got a cold, his cold is definitely not because of the curd rice, because he's been used to that for years and years. The cause for the cold must be something else. This is individuality. This is the identification of the individuality. So our treatments, diagnosis, everything is based on the region they come from, the food habits they have, the lifestyle they lead. So, you know, when the representative, medical representatives come to our clinic, they will tell me, ma'am, what are you doing with the patient for half an hour? You know, allopathic doctors, they see the patient for 10 minutes and they send them away. True, their system is different from ours. I have to understand what that person eats, what sort of lifestyle he leads, when he goes to sleep, which region he is from. To do all this, my first consultation takes about 30 minutes, because I have to understand the individual. That is when we start our treatment. The next thing is, we do something called as Prakriti analysis. That is understanding your body type. You know, we all can't fit into the same, I am completely against this body mass index, BMI. We all can't be in the same shape and size. That is not nature. We in Ayurveda, we have broadly classified people into three categories. Sorry. One is Vata Prakriti people. We call it as Prakriti. Prakriti means something you are born with. This cannot be altered. There is no good or bad about Prakriti. You are born with it and you have to adapt your diet and lifestyle based on your Prakriti. So there are one category of people who are Vata people. No matter what they eat, they remain very thin. And we keep asking them, now, what is the secret that, you know, you're so thin and so active all the time. They're usually these hyperactive types, very agile. And there is also a mind aspect to it. They grasp things very quickly. You know, if you tell them something, They grasp it very quickly, they forget it very quickly. That is a Vata type of person. And they are generally extrovert. They speak well, they interact well. This extrovert kind of people are Vata people. There are a lot more components to Vata, but I am just giving you a brief analysis, understanding of what Vata is about. The next category is Pitta. A lot of body heat. People with a general heat sort of a body. They are normally of medium build. They are very sweaty. Even in winters, they want a fan. You know, you might have come across people in your houses, your friends. Even in winter, when everybody else is feeling cold, they want a fan. Those sort of people are Pitta people. They are endowed with a very good digestion power. No matter what they eat, non-veg, veg, they are able to digest it very well. Because that fire element in their body is very predominant. And the mind part, they get very easily angry. Short-tempered sort of people. They're very hard-working and ambivert. Neither very social nor very introvert. Those sort of people. Kapha, the final one. They're always plumpy. You know, certain children from birth, they're always plumpy. And it is not wrong to be like that. It is okay to be plumpy as long as you're not overweight. So Kapha people are slightly on the plumpy side. The chubby and cute sort of people. And they have a very slow gait. In whatever they do, they are not so agile and, you know, moving like a Vata person. They are mostly slow, measured gait they have. And they have a very good skin and hair. These sort of shiny, lustrous skin and hair. And they have a very good memory. They may take their time to understand and comprehend things. But once they understand it, they are not going to forget it. Unlike a Vata person. Vata person will understand it and reproduce it. You know, these bi-hatting sort of people. They bi-hat everything, but they forget the next year. Kapha people are not like that. They take their time to understand things, but they retain it in their mind. These are some of the parameters by which we assess a person. This is just a basic example. In Ayurveda, we have about 30 to 40 different parameters to assess the Prakriti. So when you enter an Ayurveda Vaidya's clinic, the first thing the Vaidya will do is to understand you. Whether you are a Vata person, Pitta person or a Kapha person. And in my practice, what I've seen is we are not just one. Nobody can be pure Vata, nobody can be pure Pitta. We're normally a combination of two, three things. So it's like 60% Vata and 40% Pitta. That is what we normally see in our practice. After doing that, now what is Vata, Pitta, Kapha? I've been saying this, you know, Vata, Pitta, Kapha. What is this? Physicians, they have their atoms. And biologists, they have their cells. Ayurveda people, this is our basic. Vata, Pitta, Kapha. The five elements have been broken down into three major categories. And this forms the basis of Ayurveda. Our diagnosis, our medicines, everything is based on these three aspects. Vata, Pitta, Kapha. Vata means anything related to air and space. Even in our body, you have Vata. Now, when we say space, your arteries, your vessels, you know, wherever they carry blood. Anyway, when there is space, only then blood can gush in. So that space is provided by Vata. Your lungs have space. So lungs have a lot of Vata. Pitta is about fire and water. Fire is not just the digestive fire. Anything related to metabolism, anything related to hormones is Pitta. So all your digestive juices, your hormones, everything comes under Pitta. Kapha. Kapha is water and earth elements. So all these heavy elements in our body, muscles, bones, they all come under Kapha. There are not many more things to it. This is just a brief understanding of it. So this is the basis on which Ayurveda Vaidya treats you. So when you come to us with a diabetes, we are not looking at your diabetes, we are looking at your Kapha, Vata and Pitta. Even in your case, you know, if you see a diabetic, some people are overweight and they are still diabetic. Some people are so thin and they are still diabetic. Some people are so thin and they still have a very high cholesterol. You will ask them, I mean, you are so thin, where did the cholesterol come from? That is where all these doshas come into picture. That is where the differentiation between different people comes into picture. So, there is an important shloka that every Ayurveda Vaidya learns. For us, the definition of health is sama dosha. Dosha is our Vata, Pitta and Kapha. A balance between these three doshas. Sama dosha, sama agni, sama dhatu. Dhatu is all the body fluids. Rakta, mamsa, asti, everything, bones. Every equilibrium between all the body tissues. So sama dosha, sama agni, sama dhatu, malakriya. Malakriya is excretion. Prasanna atma. Prasanna means at peace or healthy. Healthy atma. Atma is your inner self. Atma, Indriyam. Indriyas, all your senses. To be able to lead a good life, you have to hear properly, you have to see properly. So, Indriyam. And then Manaha. Finally, the Manas. If everything is complete, only then we call that person as Swastha. Swastha means healthy. So, for a person to be healthy, it is not just absence of disease, it is Sama Dosha, Sama Agni, Sama Dhatu Malakriyaha and Prasannata. That is the health of the Atma, Indriya and Manas. This definition has been given by Charaka about 5000 years ago, and this is the definition of World Health Organization's definition of health. It says a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being. Sama Prasanna Atma Indriya Manaha. That is the translation of the shloka. And not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. This is the WHO definition of health. So, the 5000 year old system of medicine is still applicable today because it is based on science, it is based on logic. Next, our doubts, you know, standardization. We did have a problem before. I accept 20, 30 years back there were quacks who were giving out medicines known as Ayurveda. Ayurvedic medicines did have toxic chemicals, not now. A separate ministry called the Ayush Ministry has been constituted by the government of India. The very work of this ministry is to take care of all these things. So you have a separate union minister for Ayush. Ayush is Ayurveda, Yoga, Yunani, Siddha and Homeopathy. All the traditional system of medicines, there is a separate ministry. Earlier we were under the IMI, that is Indian Medical Association. We were under the modern system of medicine. Now we have a separate ministry for ourselves. So the standards are really shot up. The second one is all Ayurvedic pharmacy. You know the popular pharmacies, I hope, Baidyanath, Dabur, Kotakal, all these should have a GMP ISO certification. If there is a company selling medicines without these certifications, GMP is good manufacturing practice. Every pharmacy that is in the market should have these certifications. Without that, they can't sell the products. So the question of, you know, adding steroids in the products doesn't arise at all. We cannot do that because we will not get the certifications if we do that. Then, registered Ayurveda doctors. Back then, they used to give registration even for, there was something called as RMP, Registered Medical Practitioner. You know, my grandfather is a Vaidya, my great-grandfather is a Vaidya, so I'm a traditional Vaidya. They used to get a license to practice Ayurveda. That has been banned. Only doctors with a BA, MS degree or more, you know, you also have masters in Ayurveda. So only those doctors with a BA, MS or a masters in Ayurveda can practice. And BAMS is a 5.5 year course. Now you may ask me, you speak about diabetes, you speak about thyroid, do you understand it? Our BAMS course is 50% allopathic science and 50% of Ayurveda. I have studied anatomy, physiology, the same books that the MBBS person studies. I have studied surgery, I have studied gynecology. On top of it, I have studied our Ayurvedic views on the same subjects. The only thing which differs is the medicine part, pharmacology part. We have no idea about allopathic pharmacology. We enter Ayurvedic pharmacology from second year onwards. But the rest of the things are same. The same curriculum is followed. That has been drafted. There is an institution specifically for that called CCI, Central Council for Indian Medicine. They have drafted the syllabus. The syllabus is also up to date. That is, we have adapted to the modern science. So we also understand when your ears of blood reports are there, we understand what is there in the blood reports and we treat you accordingly also. Then international acceptance. This is very important for Indians, you know. Unless we have international acceptance, we don't accept it in India. WHO, about 4-5 years back, I guess, they were accorded the status of prime focus. They have a set of list of traditional regional medicines. Tibetan medicine is there, Chinese medicine, Ayurveda, homeopathy. But I'm not exactly sure about the date, but it must be 4-5 years back. They have said Ayurveda should be our prime focus. And really the international acceptance for the past 4-5 years has really become more and more. Recently, Ayush Ministry, that is the Ministry for Ayurveda, has signed a memorandum of understanding with 45 countries. So it is a long process, but in about a year or so, Ayurveda will be a legally accepted system of medicine in 45 countries apart from India. So 45 countries are mostly Asian and a few European countries like Germany and France. Okay, and then certain FDA approved drugs. are present in US. If you go to US, Amazon.com, you have Ayurvedic medicines on sale. Certain, not all of them. Some of our Ayurvedic medicines, especially from companies like Himalaya and Kotakal, some of their products have FDA approval. That is, the US FDA approval is also there. And more people are applying for it, and Ayurveda is going to go more and more in terms of international standards. Then they have also set up a committee called Pharmacovigilance. See, certain Ayurvedic doctors, including me actually, we prepare our own medicines. Ayurveda is, we use a lot of herbs in Ayurveda. So if you store the medicines for a very long time, it becomes ineffective. You know, the ladies will understand. If you make sambar powder and store it for 2 years, it is not going to be fresh. It is just sambar powder, but it is not going to have the same effect. The same applies to Ayurveda. Our herbs don't remain fresh if we buy the company brought ones. The company ones have a 2 to 3 year shelf life. So people like me, we like to make some medicines ourselves. For this, there, you know, there is a possibility. You will always have this fear that the doctor is mixing something. They have set up a committee called Pharmacovigilance Company. Regular checkups are conducted in our clinics. This came after the Ministry of Ayush was constituted. That was when the Modi government came to power 4 years back. So pharmacovigilance rates and checkups regularly happen in all our clinics. They test our products. If we make something ourselves, they test our product. Second, if you feel there is something wrong with our products, you can go to the ministry, you can register a complaint, and you know the legal process takes on. Everything is free for you, but the doctor has to pay everything if he or she has done something wrong. So pharmacovigilance is there. Ayurveda has caught up with these rules and regulations. So I think from now you can be rest assured that, you know, we are not going to add anything that is not supposed to be added. The final one is with the toxic chemicals. Let me tell you, there are something called as plant steroids. Even plants have steroids and they are not harmful to you. So when you chemically test it and say, you know, this doctor gave steroids, it is not true. Plant steroids are permissible. It is natural. Anything which contains adrenaline based ones, they all have steroids. We use ghee in most of our treatments. Ghee is tupa. We use tupa in some of our preparations. They also contain certain amounts of steroids because they are animal products, you know. They are natural steroids. That is not wrong. And yes, we also use preparations which are not herbal. We use gold, silver, and so many minerals in our everyday preparations. 90% of our preparations are herbal, but yes, we use the 10% of preparations which are not herbal. But they undergo a lot of process before we give it to you. We don't just take gold from this one and powder it and give it to you. Gold undergoes a process called as bhasmikarana. It takes about 5 days, even in a lab, even in a pharmacy, to convert that gold from gold to bhasma. The final product you get is non-toxic, and these things are only sold under this, certified this one. I can't just buy gold and sell it. You need GMP certification for gold products. And they use complex instruments like atomic spectrometer. That atomic spectrometer will test if there is any gold left, elemental gold left. Elemental gold is toxic, not gold oxide. So in that case, this is also safe. But if you're so apprehensive about it, 90% of our medicines are herbal. So you can safely opt for, just go tell your doctor, I don't want, you know, non-herbal medicines for now. Let us start with herbal. That is how you have to begin. Second, preventive medicine.
What of times they say you add lead?
Lead is also part of this one, sir. Again, it gets converted into lead oxide. And there it becomes non-toxic. Any medicine for that matter, if overdosed, is toxic. This is the problem with Ayurveda. There is a product in the market called Shilajit Gold, which men use generally to improve their potency and stuff like that. This I've seen pharmacy companies just giving it on their own. Everything should have a dosage. If given in the correct dose, medicine is medicine. If given unnecessarily, medicine also becomes toxic. The same applies to poison. Poison, if given in the correct dose, is medicine. If given wrongly, is poison. So if you take a Dolo 650, for example, every day, because you have a cold, you take a Dolo 650. Because you have body pain, you take Dolo 650. It will affect your liver. If you look at the side effects of Dolo 650, it says it is hepatotoxic. You should take these medicines only under a doctor's prescription. The same thing applies to all other medicines. We know the correct non-toxic dose for that person. So a prescription, non-herbal preparations are not toxic, and there are studies to prove that. There is a website for that if you guys are interested, NCBIM. constituted by our ministry, Ayush ministry. They will have detailed research work about all these things. I accept we have over 5,000 medicine preparations in Ayurveda. Not all of them have been researched, but we are getting there. At least 400 products which are widely used in the market, they have been researched and scientifically backed. Okay? Next is preventive medicine. This is a big thing, you know, everywhere, internationally, nationally, preventive medicine. This is the key focus of all health ministry. And I feel Ayurveda can play an absolutely wonderful role in this preventive medicine. Again, we have told this 5,000 years back. Our first goal is Swasthasya Swasthya Rakshanam, maintaining the health of the healthy. This is our first goal. The second one is treat the diseased person. So how do we go about prevention? It's in your kitchen, in your diet. So we will give you a Prakriti-based diet. Now I said Pitta person, they're prone to a lot of heat and fire. So for a Pitta person, we will say go reduce your spice levels. For a Kapha person, we will say reduce your fried oil levels. These are different for different people. For a Vata person, they are generally prone to these joint diseases, a Vata person, because they are so dry. There is a lot of air, there is no moisture in the body. So we tell them, take some healthy oils, you know, a one spoon of ghee will not hurt them, or some healthy oils like badam oil, til oil, sesame oil. These things are healthy oils. For a Vata person, we will say, take that. That means you will prevent diseases which come because of that. Pitta person, they are more prone to acidity, ulcers, gallstones, kidney stones. So reducing your spice levels will prevent all those things. We will not tell everybody to reduce the spice level. It is based on your prakriti, based on your body constitution. The second is region-specific diet. In my clinic or in most of the Ayurvedic Vaidya clinics, we are not so bad as to tell the South Indian to stop eating rice. It is not possible, because if you tell a South Indian to stop eating rice and he eats chapati all the 3 times in a day because he is diabetic, he will end up with piles, fissures and constipation. So in rice, there is a difference. Use old rice, use brown rice, and that will not harm you. This is the kind of diet we tell. For a Punjabi, if he comes with problem of piles and fissures, normally we tell them to avoid chapati. I can't tell that to that fellow. So I will tell him, after you take your chapati, you take 1 glass of jeera water. That will take down the effects of piles and fissures. So everything is specific. The second one is that there are some general things which Ayurveda says is good for everybody. Red rice. This is something you really have to use. It may not be as tasty as your raw rice, white rice, but red rice, little quantity is also very nourishing, and it is very rich in fibers. It is easily digestible. It clears most of the common problems that we face: acidity, constipation, weakness, general weakness. A lot of ladies have this, you know. By the end of the day, they're tired. They're completely tired. So that general weakness, red rice will take care of. Red rice is specifically advised for children. Children these days, some of them are plumpy, some of them are very thin, but they come up with this nutritional deficiency at a very young age. Low hemoglobin, low vitamin D, everything crops up at a very young age. Red rice takes care of all these things. It is a very good nutritious food, very healthy also. Ghee, we are completely for ghee. We don't think it is fatty. And having 1 spoon of ghee, that is tuppa, with your rice or chapati, warm chapati every day. What it does, it gives you that essential oil which is required for your body. Computer, people who use computers a lot these days, they complain of dry eye. Your eye needs some moisture. Your nose needs some moisture. There is something called as mucous membrane inside the nose. If that becomes dry, you'll again get a cold. So your nose also needs moisture. Your joints need some healthy oils. All this is present in ghee. Then til oil, that is sesame oil, this is also highly advocated in Ayurveda. It is an excellent uterine tonic taken internally. It is an excellent uterine tonic. It is very good for your hair, skin. So taking 1 spoon of eldenne every day will not harm you. You can add it to your chutneys, you can add it to your rice, whichever way you want. But start doing these simple things to make your life better. Then barley, this is again very highly advised in Ayurveda. They say people who sit a lot should have barley. So that implies most of us. We normally sit a lot. We are not going to work in a field or something. So barley, at least thrice a week will help. You can have barley water. You can mix it with your roti and have, if you know how to make rotis, you can add half of barley and half of ragi or chapati or whatever that is, wheat or whatever. Then there is something called seasonal diet. We all know this, but of late somehow we are not practicing it. You know, people with arthritis or any joint complaints, their pains will increase in the winters. And our winter traditional food is till, that is yellow. We have a lot of till sesame during winters. And off late, we have stopped having that. Yellow and bella, we have that during winters, from December to January. Peanuts. These are two things which will give you that energy to beat the cold. So having this in your seasonal, as part of your seasonal diet, will prevent the severity of the occurrence. Children end up with a lot of breathing problems during this time. So giving them yellow and bella will actually help them come out of this, will help them beat the cold. And seasonal fruits. Of late, we get all fruits in all seasons. There is watermelon in winters, there is watermelon in summers. But please stick to seasonal fruits. In that season, you eat that fruit. Oranges are seen in winters. Guava is seen in winters. They are rich in vitamin C. Vitamin C will help you prevent cold, beat cold. So God knows, nature knows what is best for us, and that is what you have in that season. Muskmelon is a must for summers. If you want to prevent dehydration during summers, if you want to prevent tiredness during summers, you have to have muskmelon. So stick to the seasonal fruit. In that season, you should have that fruit. But all seasonal fruits are bananas and apples. But I'm not a big advocate of apples, but if at all you want to have apples, it's also perfectly fine. Then there is a diet for every disease. When you see our Ayurvedic text, one portion will be the diagnosis, one portion will be the medicine, one portion, equally important portion will be the diet. So we have a specific diet for every disease. Say digestive disorders, we advocate the importance of Ajamota, that is Ajwain. That is a very important ingredient or a very important part of our prescription for digestive disorders. And when it comes to disorders of women, female problems, and we advocate a lot of curry juice. That is as important as my prescription, Ayurvedic medicine, to treat the person. So there is a diet for every disease. What is Ayurvedic lifestyle? This is basically what your grandmothers used to do and we failed to do. That is what the Ayurvedic doctor will refresh it up for you. Body oiling. This prevents a lot of problems. In Ayurveda, it is advocated daily. You have to have an oil bath daily. It may not be practical for us, so we found a practical solution. One drop of oil. If you are used to coconut oil, you use coconut oil. Or if you are used to sesame oil, yellane, you use yellane. One drop of warm oil in your nose. One each in your nostril, one each in your ears, and some oil in your hands and feet. If you can do this every day, this in itself will prevent a lot of diseases. You will age slowly. Your hearing problems will get reduced slightly. Even you will age slowly with these practices. This takes hardly 5 minutes. And if you have chronic diseases like arthritis, using Ayurvedic oil on a daily basis, you need not spend a lot of time for that. Just take a little bit of warm oil, apply to the affected joints, knee joints, back, anywhere, 5 minutes, and then take your bath. Believe me, your pain will almost reduce in a month or two. But you have to do it regularly. For a disease to come, it takes so long, you know, it takes years and years for the disease to accumulate and come in your body. For us to root it out, it is going to take a long time as well. That is why Ayurveda is slow. I forgot to add it then. There is always this, you know, this one about Ayurveda, that it is very slow. It is not so. It takes less time to just, you know, kill the pain. If you come to me with pain and I have to kill the pain, I can do that. But to uproot a disease, it takes, I'm sure it takes, you know that it takes a very long time to uproot a tree. It is like that. If we have to uproot your disease and make you completely balanced and healthy, it does take time and you have to give it the time. That doesn't make it slow, it just makes it complete. Then, never sleep during the day. This is something all Ayurvedic Vaidyas advocate. If you sleep during the day, you will gain weight, especially around the tummy and hips, which is very bad for your health. Your sugar levels will shoot up, your cholesterol levels will shoot up. Especially ladies who want to conceive and are overweight, if you sleep during the day, you cannot conceive. There is a burning problem these days called PCOS. So avoid sleeping during the day. If you are very ill or if you have lost your sleep in the night, only then you are allowed to sleep during the day, and that too not more than 45 minutes. So 2-3 hours sleep in the day is not at all healthy for you. If you want, you can go to bed really early in the night. Once the sun sets, you're free to go to bed anytime. Okay, avoid sweets after food. So the concept of desserts is completely anti-Ayurvedic. Sweets are to be taken before food, because the heaviest thing to digest should be taken in the beginning. Madura is what sweet in Ayurveda. Madura you have to have in the beginning. So a little bit of sweet in the beginning, nothing in the end. And there is also one more remedy. They say that have ginger and lavana as salt. So lavana and ardvaka. This you have to take half an hour before food. You know, a lot of children and even elder people, they complain, you know, I'm not at all hungry. I don't want to eat. That is because they have a coating around the tongue. They will be hungry in the stomach, but the taste will not be there. They'll have a whitish coating around the tongue. To get rid of that, a small piece of ginger, one piece of rock salt. Taking half an hour before food, just chew it. That will take care of your simple, you know, digestion problems. Then bath, you have to start from top to toe. Ayurveda has a system for everything, from bathing to cutting your nails to everything, there is a system for that. So for baths, they say you have to start from toe and go all the way up to the top. Back then they used to take bath in rivers, so that was easily applicable. In your house you can make a small change, because you know when you put water directly here, it moves downwards. That will cause a lot of, I mean, all the cold vayu. We call it as Vayu Ayurveda. Vayu tends to move downwards, so you'll have a lot more pains. Back pains and neck pains will increase if you pour from up. Start simple change, toe to top, see if it works for you. Exercise. No matter you are thin or fat or not, you have to exercise every day. And overdoing exercise. This is another problem that we face amongst youngsters these days. They're so enthusiastic to lose weight or be healthy. They overdo everything. You have to exercise only till there is sweating in your forehead. Once you start sweating from your forehead, you have to stop exercising. If you overdo it, you end up injuring your body, your muscles and your joints. Okay? Now I'll come to a few disorders, just giving you a brief idea about how we can tackle it in Ayurveda. Respiratory disorders, very common. What I see a lot these days amongst kids is allergic bronchitis. Cold cough, but there is nothing in the chest. Chest is free. There is no congestion in the chest. It is all in the, we call it as upper respiratory. Nose, throat. That is where the entire problem is, because of the allergens. There is a lot of dust in the environment. There is a lot of pollution in the environment. That causes allergic bronchitis. Then dry cough. This is what people come to us in Ayurveda a lot these days. There is absolutely no congestion in the chest, even in adults. They would have taken a course of antibiotics. They'll keep coughing night and day, especially more in the night. There is nothing coming out, just a bit of white phlegm. They would have taken a course of antibiotics 10, 15 days, it will not work. Somebody will tell them, you try that Ayurveda, it worked for me, they'll come to us then. And believe me, we've got very efficient medicines for dry cough. Dry cough doesn't need an antibiotic. In India, we are abusing antibiotics, not even overusing. I'm not saying antibiotics is bad. You need antibiotics only when you need it. If you have pneumonia, I can't do anything. You have to take antibiotics for that. But not for a dry cough. I can very well treat your dry cough. So for simple things, don't take antibiotics. Don't harm your health even more. There is another bigger problem called as antibiotic resistance. You keep taking antibiotics for simple things. But in future, God forbid, you get a major disease. Your antibiotics will not work because your body has become resistant to it. So whatever you give will not work. So for simple things, turn to Ayurveda. And any wise Ayurveda physician will refer you to a modern medicine if things are beyond our control. We have no answers for antibiotics where you actually need them. We also have no answers for surgical problems. Yesterday a patient came to me for hernia. Some Siddha Vaidya had given him medicines, it didn't come down. I said, hernia can't be treated with medicines. You need surgery for that. So wherever you need surgery, wherever you need antibiotics, go. But for simple things, for things which are chronic, you come to Ayurveda, we can handle it much better. So respiratory problems, Ayurvedic solutions. I'll give you a brief idea. This is not the main thing we do, but you get an idea. Nasya. I told you about, you know, there's no congestion in the chest, mostly nose deep, allergic rhinitis and bronchitis. There we do something called as nasya. You can see in the picture, we are pouring medicines through the nose, nasal medications, medicated oil, medicated decoction, a few drops of it are instilled through the nose. This is excellent in most of our upper respiratory tract disorders. That is something throat and above. Works wonderfully in tonsillitis, works wonderfully in adenoids. Children have this nose block. You know, they have some growth here. That's called adenoids. It works very well there. And in most of the dry cough, rhinitis, they wake up in the morning and sneeze some 30, 40 times. That is called allergic rhinitis. In all these, Nasya works wonderfully well. Then there is something called Dhumrapan, not the Dhumrapan that you know. This is medicated Dhumrapan. All our herbs are burnt and you are given Dhuma with that. Completely clears up your chest. I've seen green phlegm vomit after giving Dhumrapan to my patients. It completely clears up your chest. So you normally don't need a nebulization if you're taking Dhumrapan. Not in all cases. There are cases where you need nebulization. But for every small thing, you don't need a nebulization. You can take Dhumrapan. Then internal medication. This is definitely a part. Palatability is a big issue in Ayurveda. Ayurvedic medicines are not very tasty. But that is something, you know, we have made our mind. 2 minutes of bitterness in the morning, 2 minutes of bitterness in the evening is okay. 24 hours with 4 minutes if you can't devote to your health. What can I say? For children, we normally give them churnas, powders, mixed with honey. So palatability is not an issue for children. For adults, you know, that much you can do. I'm sure even your allopathic medicines are not that tasty. Have you ever tasted a Dolo 650? You swallow it? Yes. It's not that tasty either. So palatability is not an issue. It is mostly in the mind. Your role. I'll give you a few simple tips that you can take home. Turmeric. We all know this, but what we normally do is we use store-bought turmeric, the packet turmeric, which is not turmeric. It is maida and color. So spend a little bit of effort, buy fresh turmeric or pure turmeric powder. It is available in all organic stores these days. You get pure turmeric powder. Spending a 20-30 rupees extra on turmeric is totally worth it. Turmeric milk is the best for children. You have to make it like tea. Even for adults, any allergic problem, take turmeric tea. Instead of tea powder, you add turmeric powder. So half cup of water, half cup of milk, 1 spoon of turmeric, boil it and drink it. Don't add sugar, just drink it. Steam inhalation, we know this but we don't do it. The moment you get a cold, start steam inhalation. Then it will not progress to a cough or a congestion or phlegm. So simple steam inhalation, 5 minutes in a day, you are saved, your kids are also saved. Then pachakarpura, I don't know how many people use it. There is edible camphor. If you go to temples, you will know all the teethams contain this. This is a wonderful bronchodilator. So pachakarpura is available in all these traditional stores in Granbiga and Indian, all you get it. You also get it in big supermarkets. I've seen that in Moore and in Spar hypermarket. So 1 small piece of pachakarpura and 1/2 liter of water. Dissolve it, keep it for 10 minutes. Drink that water the moment you have some chest condition. Along with the medications, if it is too severe, you have to take medications. Along with that, drink this pachakarpura water. Your bronchodilators. What is bronchodilators? You have these tubes inside the lungs, small tubes. They get constricted. They become small when you get a cold or a congestion or a cough. So if you dilate it, you can breathe easily. That is what this pachakarpura does. It will dilate your bronchioles in a very natural way. This is doable. Do it. Very simple, very tasty also. Tulasi water, again very easy, same concept. It is also a bronchodilator. So if your kids or you yourself fall sick, 2 leaves of tulsi, 1 cup of water, boil it and drink it. 3-4 cups in a day. Fermentation. I've had very good results with it. Fermentation is ferment the chest. Heat a cloth or a hot water bag if you have, place it on the chest. Immediately you will see relief. Heat a cloth in a tawa, dry tawa, you need not add anything. Heat that cloth. When it is bearable heat, place it on the chest, place it mostly on the back. Lungs are nearer to the back than your chest. In your chest, you have a lot of ribs and the sternum. In the back, it is more reachable, especially here. So place it here for your kids, for yourself. Place it in all these regions and you will have immediate relief from cough. Next, we'll talk to digestive disorders, mostly seen in aged people. You have acidity, you have constipation, malabsorption syndrome. This we are seeing in youngsters also these days. You are eating a lot of green leafy vegetables, still you are anemic. Why? Because your body is not able to absorb whatever you are eating. Your child is eating a nutritious food, you are giving everything for your child. But your child is still deficient in nutrition because the child is not able to absorb it. The main reason for malabsorption syndrome is the kind of diet that we have, the westernized sort of diet. They use a lot of mayonnaise, cheese and sort of preservatives. They form a coating around your tummy. So nothing gets absorbed. You know, if you use a lot of oil, nothing gets absorbed, nothing else can seep in. That is what happens. They form a coating around your tummy and nothing gets absorbed. So malabsorption syndrome is one major thing that we are seeing and we can treat it very effectively with Ayurveda. The other one is IBS and Crohn's. You must, I don't think you know the technical term, but IBS you would have seen around you, irritable bowel syndrome. Whenever they eat, they have to go to toilet. Because their bowel gets irritated every time they eat something. I'm sure you would have met people like that. Whenever they eat something, they immediately go to toilet, 3 to 4 times in a day. That is irritable bowel syndrome. This normally happens for people who take a lot of outside food. You know, because some infection, chronic infection, it causes irritable bowel syndrome. In Ayurveda, it is completely treatable. There is also a disease called Crohn's, which is the next stage of IBS. That is, your intestines will be like pipes. The pipe will get narrowed because of chronic infection. Crohn's is not completely reversible, but we can stop further degeneration very well with Ayurveda. So for these things, we normally advise detox therapies. We induce purgation. We induce loose motion some 10-12 times. I've done this probably for about 100-120 cases till now. None of them have been admitted to hospital. You know, when I first tell them 10-12 motions, what will I do after that? Should I be admitted in hospital and take a drip or something? No. Only the toxins will come out of your body. We induce purgations in your body with specific medicines. This is a 6-day detox program. And I suggest everybody should take it at least once a year. Detox will prevent most of your diseases and cure your digestive disorders. So, if obesity, because suffering from chronic obesity, a couple of detoxes, you lose about 5-10 kilos, and when you walk, work out, you will lose all the extra kilos that you have had. So detox is used in so many things. The other thing we do is enema. This might sound very scary to you. Enema is giving medicine through the anal route. It is not at all painful. Believe me, it is much easier than this purgation, loose motion thing. We make our kashayams and we give it through the anal route. It completely detoxifies your lower intestines. Not the upper ones, the lower intestines are completely detoxified. And I found very good results for all women problems with this. Infertility, period problems, everything gets cured with enema. Again, this is an 8-day course. Normally, our detox therapies are a course. You need to spend about 6 days or 8 days for it, but not regularly, once a year, and you'll have maximum benefit. And then you have our medications, which are very good. Our Ayurvedic churnas are very famous for constipation. You know, everybody gives a churna for constipation. That is not how it is. Find the root cause for constipation and treat it. Medications also work very well. Finally, we give you a customized diet. So for constipation, as I always say, diet is different for different people. So for constipation, is it because of dryness in the body? If you check the person, they have a lot of dryness everywhere in the skin and everything. For such a people, we'll tell them, take some healthy oils. A few drops of badam oil, a few drops of coconut oil every day at bedtime. There are other people who don't have constipation. The stools are not hard, but they're not able to pass it. That is because they have a lot of bloating, a lot of gas in the body. So when gas is filled, your bowel movements become slow. So for that person, we'll tell them take hing or take ajwain. So the diet is different for everybody. But the diet is permanent. Visit a vaidya once. Learn the diet. That is permanent. We are not going to change it. That is for your lifetime. What is your role? Do not Google your diet plans, please. I see a lot of older people, but youngsters, normally they Google everything. So you take lemon water, lemon juice every day with lot of honey to lose weight, you will end up with acidity. So consult a doctor, any doctor, before you start a diet plan. And then there is this millet rage, you know, happening everywhere in Karnataka. Take millets, millets. Millets is your ragi and the sami, all these dhanyas. Millets are not to be taken in a large quantity. Ayurveda says only people who are soldiers and farmers should take millets. That means your physical activity should be so much to digest millet. Of course, millets are nutritious, no doubt about it. They are rich in calcium, they are rich in everything, iron. But you can't make that your staple food. If you want to have millets, take one ball of millet. One ragi ball, one ragi puri hittu every day, or one little bit of sami ake added to your idlis and dosas. That is how you are supposed to take millet. For people like us, not making it a staple diet. I had a child about 2-3 weeks back, 8 months old child, and she had constipation. Allopathic people gave Dulcolax, that laxative, that also didn't work. And then after 10 days she'll pass motions, a lot of motions, and then again next 10 days she's constipated. Because the mother chose to follow the millet rate. She was giving the child millet feed 3 times in a day. Finely powdered millet with some water 3 times in a day. How can the child digest that? So millet is great, but in moderation. Then seasonal variations of diet, I already spoke about it. Vary your diet based on the season a little bit. So more nuts during the winters, more watery vegetables. So during the summer, so you know, those vegetables that we normally don't like, bottle gourd, sorekai, hirekai, these things are very good during the summers. Okay, then traditional Indian diet, I feel, is the most balanced diet. There is nothing wrong with that. You need not change our diet at all. Your grandma's diet is the most healthiest, completely balanced diet. And you know that, so follow that. That will keep you very healthy. The final thing is discipline. You can't have breakfast at 8 o'clock one day, at 10 o'clock the other day, and expect your body to digest it. There is something called as body clock. There is a clock inside the body. So if you have 8 o'clock at breakfast at 8 o'clock today, the next day body will say, Tika, release the juices now because it is breakfast time. At that time, you won't have food. You will have it at 10 o'clock. The juices are wasted. You end up with acidity. And whatever you eat at 10 o'clock doesn't get digested. So stick to a basic discipline. Your eating time, your sleeping time, there should be a discipline in it. Half an hour is okay. More than that is not okay. No matter how busy you are, you should spare 10 minutes into 3 times. That is about 20. How much is it? 10 into 3. 30 minutes every day for your food. Please do that. Sleep is also very important for digestion. If you don't sleep well, your food will not get digested. Next is bones and joint problem. Very common. There is something called osteoporosis. You can see the image there. Your bones become porous. The first one is the normal bone. The first bone you see on your left side, extreme left, is a normal bone. The lesser calcium you get, your bones become like that. And that sort of bone, the last slide, that sort of bone, if you have, the moment you fall down, your bones will break into pieces. People don't know about osteoporosis. They keep having some pain internally, they don't get it tested, and they end up with this. Last stage, we can't do anything about it. So calcium is very essential in your daily diet. Arthritis, I'm sure you all have heard about it. Pain in every joint in the body. Arthritis doesn't spare any joint. Every joint in the body will have pains. Some people have it in the milder form, so they'll have it only in the knees. But other people have it in a very severe form, all joints in the body. Pains, all sort of pains. There is something called as muscle pain, mostly seen among our IT crowd, fibromyalgia. Their bones and joints are normal, but they have a lot of muscle pain because of the kind of work they do and excessive exposure to AC. So muscle pain also we can manage with Ayurveda. How we do that? We can only prevent osteoporosis, we can't cure it. Once you get osteoporosis, we can stall it. So, you know, if you see that slide, there is a second stage and third stage. So we can stall it at that in case you have that. We have very effective calcium supplements for that. Calcium, if you take a chemical calcium supplement, there are some side effects for that. You'll have stones or, you know, your body may not be able to absorb it well. Natural calcium supplements are very effective for that. And we have effective treatments for pain management. I told you, you know, that neck pain, you can see that picture. They've created a bund around that neck. Okay, the shadow. Okay. They've just created a bund around that neck. And we pour warm medicated oil over that area. This is a 30-minute process called as Greva Basti. Excellent for all sorts of neck pain. The same process is adapted to all other body parts. Knee pain, we do this Jana Basti, that is knee Basti. Wherever you have pain, it can happen in the lower back. Like this, we have different kind of treatments in Ayurveda. There is something called as PPS. There are a few herbal leaves that we collect. We chop it into fine pieces. We add some more herbs to that. We fry it and we bundle it in a cloth. So you must have seen that picture, so I didn't get the picture. So we bundle it in a cloth and we give massage with that. That way, herbs will seep in. That is excellent for varicose veins, muscle pains, and so many other disorders. Nerve rejuvenation. Some pains are not at all related to bone, they are related to your nerves. Nerve pain, luckily, we can completely rejuvenate it. We can cure you. Even in Ayurveda, arthritis has no cure, but we can make you pain-free. We can make you lead a normal life with a few diet and lifestyle restrictions. But nerve pain, we can completely reverse it. We can rejuvenate your nerves with our medicines. And of course, the Ayurvedic diet and lifestyle. Self-help, your answer, sir. Exercise, this is the first thing everybody should do the moment you cross 30. The moment you cross 30, your bones and joints become weaker and weaker. Spend 10 minutes in your house or in your office. Exercise every single joint of yours. Wrist joint, rotate your wrist, rotate your elbow, 5 times each. So easy to do. rotate your shoulders, same with your legs, rotate your ankles, rotate your knees. Spend 10 minutes on this every day. Joint exercises are very important. If you have the time, please go learn it from a trained yoga therapist. There are some pain specific asanas also. That is a different topic, so I didn't come to that. Now, regular body oiling. If you have oil bath, your joints and muscles are protected for a very long time. Once a week, I'm sure you can do that. Please tell your family members also, once a week, having oil bath is excellent for you. Then there are some healthy oils that you have to take internally. Our joints have calcium. I'll come to the natural calciums. Milk is an excellent source of calcium. In case you have an allergy to milk, you know, some people get bloating or something when they take milk. Buttermilk is an equally good source of calcium. Buttermilk, you will not catch a cold with buttermilk. Buttermilk means you have to churn it. At least whip it for 1 second in the mixie. Adding water to curd is not buttermilk. You have to whip it. Only then it is buttermilk. And taking one glass of buttermilk, you will not catch a cold. Preferably take it in the afternoon. For all ladies and gents above 40, one glass of buttermilk or milk every day is compulsory, whichever suits you. Then there is something called as Gond Katira. In Kannada, they call it as Badami Gondu. In Hindi, it is called Gond Katira. Is anybody aware of it? Badami Gondu. That is, it is a raisin. It is an extract from a plant. It is available in all these traditional stores. Antu antanu helthare Kannadalli. They make antunde for all these ladies after delivery. That is a rich source of calcium, very easily absorbable. If you bite at Gond, it will be in the form of crystal. Add 1 spoon of ghee, fry that. 1 handful of Gond you add, fry it. It will become very brittle. It will puff up like corn. Then you crush it. Don't powder it in a mixie. Just crush it in a mortar and pestle. 1/2 spoon of that Gond powder, you add it to milk or you just take it in. It is tasteless. Sumne hange kuda thogabodu. Take it in twice a week. Dina kuda beda, twice a week. You can add it to your chapati. You can add it to whatever you want. Don't add it to milk and boil it. Bisi haalige 1/2 spoon of Gond you can add. That's an excellent source of calcium. Then dates are rich in calcium. If you are not a diabetic, you can take dates. And saporta is also an excellent source of calcium, especially for children. I told you, children also come up with calcium deficiency these days. Saporta, one every day, is excellent. Saporta is also available in most of the seasons. So you can safely give them saporta. Then healthy oils, children or adults, you have to take some healthy oils. Joints are like machines. You need to grease it. If you go on a zero-fat diet, poor joints, you know, what will they do? There is no grease. So you will develop arthritis, you will develop pain. So 1 spoon of ghee, as I told you, in your daily diet is compulsory. Almond oil, very good. People with a cardiac concern are very scared to take ghee. I mean, I would give a ghee even for a cardiac patient. But if you are very scared and skeptical about it, almond oil is completely safe. It is available in all grocery stores also. I mean, all Patanjali, Ramdev's almond oil is very nice. It's called Badam Rogan. So about 4 to 6 drops of badam oil in warm water or milk. Take it every day. It will take care of your joints and your eyes. Then sesame oil, that is till oil, that is also very good for you. You have to eat till also. Eating till every day or, you know, in the season works very well. That yellow you have to eat, yellow day or something, you have to eat. Mustard, I think most of us add in our daily diet. If you are cooking the South Indian way, we add a little bit of mustard. Mustard has a lot of heat, so it manages your pains very effectively. Then acceptance and positive spirit. This is required. You know, if you have arthritis, your life is not doomed. It is okay. So many people have arthritis. Accept it and just work on it a little bit. That is what is required. Metabolic disease. This is a huge issue these days. Very, very huge. To the extent that India may be declared a metabolic epidemic in 2030. That is the extent of metabolic diseases. And it suddenly started raising in India, the incidences. So among metabolic diseases means in your body, digestion and metabolism is not happening properly. Whatever you eat has to be broken down into fat and sugar. Sometimes it gets broken down into excess sugar, sometimes it gets broken down into excess fat and energy. 3 things it has to break down into: sugar, fat and energy. Sugar is for immediate use. Energy, that is, you know, it is given immediately. The fat is for storage. You need little bit of fat, but too much fat is a problem. So if your food gets broken down wrongly, that is, there is very little energy coming out of food, but lot of fat, that means you have a metabolic disorder. So that is what metabolic disease means. So metabolic disease includes diabetes, obesity, hypertension, thyroid, PCOS. PCOS, again, India, there are about 50% of patients with PCOS are from India alone. PCOS is polycystic ovary disease. There are cysts in the ovaries of women, which makes it impossible for them to conceive. This is completely reversible. Earlier you come to us, we can reverse it completely. So keep all these things in mind. Ayurvedic remedies, again, we go for the detox diet. We use a herb called gugulu. There are a lot of preparations out of gugulu. Gugulu works wonders in metabolic diseases. Amla. Amla, if you take, that absorption part and that metabolism part works wonderfully well. In the season, cook amla. You can just steam that amla. One nelika, better nelika, you can just steam it and have it. Mix it with your food. It is not all that sour. It is quite tasty. Or you can have amla juices also. Then we give a lot of kashayams, kahirate kashayams, but they're very effective in helping you lose weight, manage your thyroid and other things. Help yourself. If you have a metabolic problem, simple self-help is, for if you are suffering from obesity or thyroid, 30 minutes walk in a park is not enough. So people come to me and say, na dina walk martini doctor, but that is not enough for you. You have a much serious problem. So you have to do mostly rigorous exercises. So a combination of walking and yoga or cycling, badminton, depends on the age. Based on the age, for a younger person, I'll say go for cycling every day. For older people, try to do yoga. But rigorous exercises must if you have to treat these metabolic disorders. You can't just treat it like that. And herbal tea, this is very effective. You might be having 2 cups of tea, worst cases, 3 cups of tea in a day. In that, make 1 cup herbal tea. Herbal tea is whatever spices you have at home, lavanga, elaki, and chakke, everything, little, crush it. Don't powder it. Crush it lightly, coarsely, and then make a tea out of it. This is excellent for metabolism. Okay, barley. This is highly indicated in Ayurveda, especially for diabetes and cholesterol. Barley, if you can include in your breakfast, barley, you get barley powder these days. So 1 spoon of barley powder and warm water, one ganji tara agutte. 1 cup of barley ganji as part of your breakfast. You have 2 dosas and 1 barley ganji. That itself will keep your diabetes at bay. Then warm water. This is simplest and best. Warm water, if you have 1 liter every day, works very well in losing weight. I had a patient of mine and I told her, you have 1 liter of warm jeera water every day. She was very obese. She was about 30 kilos extra. I don't know what came to her. She thought she has to have 4 liters of jeera water in a day. She had 4 liters of jeera water. After 1 month, she lost 8 kgs with nothing. Just warm, 4 liters of warm water. I myself was surprised. I didn't know this. That is how effective warm water is. So even if you don't have 4 liters, 1 liter or worst case 2 cups of warm water in a day, you have to have. Eat on time. That is when your body told you this already. If you don't eat on time, your body will not digest it. Sleep on time. Same thing. Don't sleep at 12 o'clock one day and wake up at 8 o'clock. That doesn't work. Because during your sleep, the final metabolism happens. So children grow during their sleep. Elders, your nerve rejuvenation happens during your sleep. So if you don't sleep, what is the use? If you have a sleep issue, address it immediately. Geriatric disorder.